Hi, my name is David Salgado. I work as a product manager on the data team. And on this video, I'm going to walk you through the steps to create an application with SQL Server on Linux. As you can imagine, for your application, it doesn't matter if you're hosting your data on SQL Server on Linux or on Windows. At the end of the day, it's going to just be a connection string. And it doesn't matter if it's on the cloud, if it's on premises, it's just the changes on that connection stream. However, as a developer, you may want to have everything installed on your machine. And that's what we are going to walk you through, how to install, manage, connect, and deploy your application, assuming that OS X or Linux will be your primary OS. And when I say installation, I mean that as for Windows, we have had native installation packages. Now, if you're a Linux user, you can find SUSE, Red Hat, or Ubuntu packages. So if you're an Ubuntu user, you can just apt-get MS SQL Server on Linux. And of course, we have Docker images for both Windows and Linux. Once you have installed your database, you will need to manage it. And usually on Windows, you do that using SQL Server Management Studio, SSMS. You can still use SSMS from Windows to connect to a SQL Server on Linux machine, but we have two new tools that we want to show you. One is going to be a Visual Studio Code extension, and the other one is the command line tools for SQL Server. Once you have installed and once you have created the database with all the tables, we have the connection point, where you are going to create that connection string and you are going to use a specific driver to connect your application to the database server. We have connectors for all those languages and more. And also, if you don't find the language that it's your personal preference, please let us know so we can work on it. And after that, we will talk about where can you deploy your application once it's finished. On the demo today, we are going to show you how to create a Node.js application that is going to be hosted on a Docker image on Linux, and we are going to use a couple of those management tools that I told you about. But also, I'm going to show you a couple of different features of SQL Server, because if we think about SQL Server as a Swiss Army knife, when we store and retrieve information, we are just using the toothpick. We are not taking advantage of all the features that we have available. So especially now, that with this new version of SQL Server, you will have access to all the programming features that were available for enterprise, developer, or standard versions of the product. But if you're using SQL Server 2016, let me remind you that you have to install the Service Pack 1. We announced it back in November. And once you install it, you will have access to all the features for all the editions of SQL Server. Let's go to the demo. So we are going to start by installing SQL Server on Linux. In order to do that, we have several options, and we have this side that lines all the options based on your preferred language. In this case, we are going to work with Node.js on macOS. So when I click here, I have the instructions for my OS. So I have already gone through those steps to save a little bit of time. If I come here, I chose the Docker option. So if I check my Docker images, we are going to have SQL Server on Linux here. I also have another images that have the server plus tools plus connectors plus frameworks. But in this case, I'm going to use the base machine. And I have already also a container created that I can show you here. It's the SQL Server on Linux base image. And I have called it SQL employees because I have already created a database and I have already filled it with some information. Let me start that container. Docker start SQL employees. And as soon as it starts, it's up now, we have to manage the database. We have to insert information, create indexes, or whatever we need to do. And for that, as I told you before, we can use the command line tools, MS SQL. I'm going to connect to a server that is localhost. I'm going to use the user SA with the password egunon17. That means good morning in Basque, just for you to know. And I'm going to run this query. Select add version. See, we are connecting to SQL Server. But instead of using the command line tools, I'm going to use Visual Studio Code. Because we have this extension that is free and you can find on the marketplace. And with this extension, when I'm on a SQL file that it's recognized as a SQL file, as we can see below here, I have available those SQL commands. Whoops. Those SQL commands that I can use to connect, disconnect, execute queries, and so on and so on and so on and so forth. So when I click on connect, I'm going to see a list with all the profiles that I have already created. This is just telling the extension where is my server, which is the database that I want to use, which is the user, blah, blah, blah. I have VideoAmp here. Now it's supposed to be connected to VideoAmp. So I can just select and run queries from Visual Studio Code. This is the same one that we run from the command line. And this is just another simple query to show you that we have some data into the database. So once we have seen this, the next step is connecting the application that I have created with SQL Server on Linux. On this case, we are using Node, and with Node, you can use TDUS. And TDUS actually comes from TDS, is the acronym for the protocol that you use to connect to SQL Server. And it's as easy as creating the connector, specifying the details of the database that you are going to connect to, and done. If I run this program, woohoo, let's make a small change here so you see that is actually happening. Node, hello world. Woohoo, connected, done. Super easy. However, we don't usually use the driver directly. We, as a developer, we usually use an ORM. If you're using .NET, you use Entity Framework. If you're using Node, you will probably use SQLize. So we have the same protocol here. I use SQLize. SQLize underneath uses TDUS. I specify which are the details for the database that I'm going to connect to. And this is a super simple code that you can find on the website. Creates a user, creates a task, and does a little bit of work with the user and the task. Assigning it, changing the data, changing the date, and deleting the task. So if I run this sample, node ORM demo, here below you can see that it worked, and all the information that was sent to the console, to the output. And I also told you that I was going to share a couple of features that are not usually recognized by developers, so that as a developer, maybe we don't know because we store information, retrieve information, and done. So first of all, let's think about this JSON feature. As developers, we run a query. That query brings us back a table. Then we go through the table. We go back to the database to gather more information based on the information that we have on the table. So we have a back and forth queries with the server until we build the hierarchy that we need on the application side of things. So instead of doing that, we can use either JSON or XML and actually return hierarchies from the server. So we can better represent object and relationship between objects just with information that is coming from the database. So as you can see, same query, I'm just adding that I want the return information in JSON, and this is the root node that I'm gonna use. Let me execute it. And of course, this is gonna require you to make some changes on the application side, because your application has to be ready to send and receive JSON from the database, but this is super convenient. Okay, and as you can see here, this is just the information from the table with the node that I have specified, but I can always play a little bit more with the format that I'm requiring the database to send me. As you can see here, I have created the employee entity, I have created the contact entity, and I can just use this on the application side. And don't save. And this was a feature that you can use, but you will need to change something on your application side. The next one, it's Columnstore indexes, and you don't need to change anything on the application side. First of all, let me create this table. This is basically, as the name says, a 5 million rows table. And I'm going to run this query. I'm going to run this query so we see how much time does it take to calculate the sum of one of those columns on a table with 5 million rows. I execute it, and this is going to be around 900 milliseconds. I'm going to execute it again. So you see that this is pretty consistent, 900 milliseconds. So now I'm going to use this feature that has been available for a long time on SQL Server, but now on the latest versions, it has been improved. I'm creating a cluster Columnstore index that is going to help us with analytical workloads and reducing the time and the space that we need for certain queries. So we see that it has been created. I'm going to do the same query again, measuring the time. It was 900 milliseconds, and now it's 17. And I'm going to do it again, and again, 7 milliseconds. So as you can see, there are so many features available on SQL Server for applications that both you can use from the application side of things as a developer that is trying to get a little bit more productivity when you're working against the database, and also on the server side that you can just enable few things like this Columnstore index, and you can get amazing gains on performance, security, analytics, and so on and so forth. And we're back to the slides. And now that we have created, managed, and connected our application to SQL Server on Linux, the only missing stage is deploying that application. And based on your preferences, your environment, and your company, you may want to decide to deploy to an on-premises server, like SQL Server or SQL Data Warehouse. You can publish it to any kind of Docker-based container infrastructure, like Kubernetes or Swarm, or you can publish it to the cloud with those Windows as a services, or maybe you have another cloud of preference, or even your hoster. I hope that this video was a good overview of what can you do with SQL Server on Linux and all the steps that you need to go through to install it, manage, connect, and deploy your applications. If you need more information or want to find the sample code that we have used, please browse akams/sqldev. You will find all the information there. Thanks for watching this video.